Welcome back to the 1% Show. If you're new here, tune in to hear me spin the yarns with authors, savants, and eccentric humans every week. Today on the 1% Show,
there's going to be moments of romance on the road, and they might end disastrously. I'll give you an example. I actually met a Belgian woman in Egypt, and then we later met up in Thailand, and it just felt really nice. It felt really right in Thailand. So she invited me to visit her for Christmas in Brussels, and almost like within 90 seconds of arriving, it just fell apart. Like, we were completely different people.
Wow.
We were sort of performing versions of ourselves in Thailand, and then we were just deeply, deeply not meant to be together. And so it was a deeply depressing time. She was sort of mean, actually. And I was sort of pathetic. But that was good to know. You know, it was a horrible experience, but my life, and we've since become friends in a much more practical sense. But I learned that way, that there's that you can idealize versions of yourself while you're traveling and realize that that's not who you are and that's not who the other person is. And so even though that's a very negative, it was a very negative experience. It was very stressful at time, or at least the breakup was. It helped me get to know myself, you know, and perhaps she got to know herself better too.
I'm your Aussie host, Brandon Nankivell, and it's time to kick back and enjoy the show. Let's go. This episode is brought to you by Blinkist, a pretty sweet app that gives you key insights from over 2,000 best-selling nonfiction books, transformed into powerful packs you can read or listen to in just 15 minutes. These powerful packs are known as Blinks. Some of my favorite blinks include Super Intelligence, Deep Work, and The Subtle Art of Not Giving a Fuck. Head to Blinkist.com/1%better to get started. That's Blinkist, Blinkist.com/1%better. 1% better is all words, lowercase, no spaces. Again, head to Blinkist.com/1%better to access key insights from over 2,000 best-selling nonfiction books straight from your phone. So to the listeners listening in right now, we've got Rolf Potts on the show, author of Vagabonding. So welcome, Rolf.
Glad to be here.
Fantastic. So could you just give us a brief overview of who you are and what it is that you do?
I'm Rolf Potts. I'm a travel writer and author. And my core philosophy is vagabonding, which is also the name of my book, which is about traveling not just for a week or two on vacation, but for traveling in earnest for a year or two, something that you Australians do better than the Americans. And more than just a plan of action, it's sort of a philosophy that emphasizes seeing time as your truest form of wealth. Not possessions, not money, but using what money you have to actualize your time in such a way that you can live your travel dreams, not in some future time when you think it's right, but right now, as soon as possible, at a time when you are excited about travel. You know, one of the reasons why that is that people tend to put off travel. And so it's about making a plan and making it happen.
Brilliant. Yeah, thanks for that, Rolf. So just right now, just to get a feel for what you're doing right now, what does a typical day look like for you right now?
Well, I'm blessed by rarely having typical days, actually. My days are pretty strange. Like yesterday, I spoke to a writing conference in Idaho recently. So yesterday was a travel day. The day before involved talking to groups of people in another city. I'm actually on a deadline for a book about travel students right now. And so my routine involves, a day in the life here on my place in Kansas involves waking up at 7 and getting really, really caffeinated and then just hitting that deep focus that is required to write, and doing that for about 4 hours, and then having lunch, and then maybe doing some more writing or doing some more research. I use the Scrivener program as a writing tool. So I'm in writing mode, and that's probably as predictable as my life come in the year cycle. You know, a couple of months ago, I was in Southern Africa driving a four-wheel drive through Mozambique or walking around on the skeleton coast of Namibia, which is much less given to a regular day in the life, though much more exciting to talk about than task of sitting writing book. Being very quiet and focused all day. So
Great. So you mentioned, I think you said Scrivener. Is that what you said?
Yeah, Scrivener is just a research organization tool that I use when writing. When I was writing Vagabonding, I was living in this little room in Thailand, and I had like 500 note cards that I taped to the wall. And Scrivener, in a certain sense, is like a computer program version of that. It allows you to upload all of your research and thoughts into this interface that allows you to move information and ideas around in a very easy way. In a way, it's like moving those note cards around on the wall, but much, much easier and more convenient. And you don't even have to write things down with the pen. You just cut and paste your ideas and research. And for my last three or four projects, I've really found myself dependent on it. And I don't mean to accidentally sound like an advertisement for Scrivener, but for someone with the same writing habits as me, I'm very research driven and very big on organizational structure. I think structure is an important part of writing. Scrivener has been an invaluable tool. And so sometimes when my creative brain is too tired to literally put sentences together, I'll go back to the Scrivener file and just sort of push ideas around, let my subconscious work on it, and then return to my caffeinated state the next day and mm-hmm. start again.
Yeah, thanks for filling us in, because I'd heard this Scrivener program going around back when I was in the ebook publishing community, and I thought, you know, what on earth? Don't you just need, you know, Google Docs or Microsoft Word and you're good to go? So I was always curious about that, so thanks for filling us in. But yeah, so moving on, could you take us back to when you were 14 years old? What was life looking like for you at that age?
I think at 14, I just figured out that I didn't actually want to be a dentist. When I was 13, for some reason, I thought, oh, I'll be a dentist. You can make good money and you don't have to go to school that much. Well, you know, I hadn't thought about it that carefully. Mm-hmm. And in fact, 14 is when I sort of started reading books in such a way that I realized that I sort of wanted to write books. Now, when I was 14, I was reading Stephen King books. And so I started writing Stephen King style stories. And so I think that age is significant for me more from a writing perspective than a travel perspective. I think I hadn't quite figured out travel. It would be a few more years before I started thinking of travel in a big picture existential sense. But I was thinking about my own creative life, what I might eventually want to become. And I had started this process of sort of reading as a writer, of being engaged by a story or an essay and thinking, I want to try that. So in a way, the seeds of my writing life, if not my travel life, go back to age 14.
So what about when coming into high school, so maybe 18 or 19, was there any significant events that happened there just as you were coming out of high school?
There's a couple, and I'll tell you the second one first. And I was 20 years old. It was the summer between my sophomore and junior year in university, using American terms. But I was working at a supermarket as a shelf stocker overnight, and I was also interning at a television station. And I really hated my job, and I was really dreaming of travel. I think that the wanderlust itch had really kicked in. And in the context of work, I realized that any job that I didn't really love, anything I did just for money, was going to be a metaphorical extension of putting tuna fish and peanut butter on a grocery store shelf. You know, if I didn't love what I did, it would just be another version of this summer job that I hated. And I think I discovered the urgency of travel. I realized that not only should I see travel as something that was in my future, but something that made travel in my near future. The other big turning point was probably 3 years earlier when I was 17. And I was thinking about my grandfather, who was a Kansas farmer and worked hard his whole life and was getting ready to retire. But about the time he retired, my grandmother, his wife, was diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease, and he'd worked hard his whole life. If anybody had deserved his free time and retirement at the end of life, it was him. But life didn't reward him with free time. He, you know, by the obligations and love of my grandmother, he stayed and took care of her. And so I realized that if anybody had earned his retirement, it was my grandfather, and that if I wanted to travel, I would have to do it while I was young. And so that sort of simmered in my subconscious. And then when I was 20 and I was working, then something snapped, and I thought, I need to put a date on the calendar. And I think that was the summer of 1991. This betrays how old I am. This is 1991 is when I was 20 years old. And it was New Year's Day, 1994. So, and that's when I left on my first vagabonding trip. And in a certain sense, I've never come back. So,
incredible. What sort of financial position were you in at the time?
Well, I was a college student. In the United States, going to university often involves a huge amount of debt. I was lucky enough through various circumstances, including scholarships and the fact that my father had worked at a university job, I was able to finish college without debt. And that was key. I mean, these days, the millennial generation in America, they have crippling debt. You can finish college with $100,000, $200,000 of debt. That's crazy. Mm-hmm. That means you're in your 40s until you're debt free. Mm-hmm. It's just insane. Anyway, so I was blessed to be able to finish college without debt. And I worked as a landscaper for 6 months and earned maybe $6,000. And I spent $5,000 traveling the U.S. by van for 8 months. And so obviously I was eating a lot of ramen noodles and sleeping in my van a lot. But I was not in debt, but yet I did not have much money. But I had an awesome time. I've told people before that you can only travel America once when you're 23, which is just sort of a roundabout way of saying that your first trip is a special one. And even though I've been to more exotic places and I've probably had more meaningful experiences, there was something just truly amazing about that. I think I felt the gratitude of being able to do this in a keen way. Like every day I was just thankful to be out on the road and living in an exciting way that just a few years earlier I didn't think was possible at that age. And so your question was about finances, but I think finances, because I was living so frugally, really weren't that much of a factor. I just traveled within the shell of my own financial possibility. And I still do that. I travel in a much more comfortable way. I travel frugally, but I no longer find myself sleeping in vans quite as much. I will never eat as much top ramen noodles as I did in 1994 ever again in my life. Yeah. But that's the thing. I think you mentioned Tim Ferriss earlier before the interview. And, mm-hmm. and when I interviewed him, he was telling me a story about trying to get a bunch of billionaires together for a conference. And it was hard to do because none of the billionaires had time, which is a strange thing. You have all this money in the world, but it means there's more responsibility and more property. And these very cash rich people were very time poor. And so I was a time rich person, even though I was cash poor. And I've continued to try and maximize my time wealth as my life has moved forward.
Wow. What's your advice to teenagers and millennials who've just finished school and they want to travel the world, but money is simply holding them back? What's your advice?
I'd say a little bit of patience goes a long way. I think there's a lot of teenagers and millennials who want me to say, just go, you know. I think, like, I was able to work for 8 months to earn enough money to travel for 8 months. And those, even though I would have loved to just hit the road immediately, I just couldn't do it. And I could have, you know, played a guitar at the side of the road or worked in a supermarket or a youth hostel and made money as I traveled. But it just made more sense to just live very frugally, make as much money and save as much money as possible, and then hit the road. So, at age 20, how old was I? 22, 23, 8 months seemed like a long time, much more than it does now, but it was so key. Like I could just travel without, even though I had only had $6,000 to work with, somehow it took the cash pressure off. By just putting my travels off 8 months, I was able to travel to my heart's content, really. So my first piece of advice is realize that you can make a decision to travel, but it doesn't mean you're going to leave the door tomorrow. So a little bit of, deferring your wishes, the fulfillment of your wishes goes a long way. And I think work that sucks is more joyful if you have this goal at the end of the tunnel of all that work. So I would say do your research, get excited, know how to travel cheaply. There's a lot of great ways from, couch surfing to hitchhiking to save money. And earn your money and sock it away, and just know that Thai food is going to taste just as good, and the German beer is going to go down just as well 8 months or a year or 2 years from now when you have enough money to actually make that happen. And if you like to fly by the seat of your pants, and if you run out of money in Germany, then you can get that under the table job at the Bierhof serving beer. Just another thing too is just remember that there's no pressure to do everything now. I remember what it was like to be a teenager in my early 20s and just feeling this urgency, and it's okay. It's good to feel that urgency because that inspires you to actually get out and do things. But if you live your life mindfully, you can indulge in these things your whole life. So a little bit of patience now pays off in great ways as life moves forward. And so just get that vicarious buzz of anticipation. But if you don't have money today, then find a way so that you can have a lot of money or more money than you thought you might have a few months or years down the line. Does that make sense?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, thanks for that. And I also want to quickly rewind. My curiosity is burning. You mentioned hitchhiking. This is something I've been interested in doing a long time, and maybe some listeners listening in right now have thought about doing it, or maybe they're dead shit scared of, hopping into a stranger's car. I actually pick up hitchhikers myself because I myself, when I go traveling next, want to hitchhike when it makes sense to do so. But do you have any tips regarding overcoming fear and making sure, you get a safe person to hitchhike with? And tips to, you know, get picked up?
Well, I'm not, like, I hitchhike a fair amount, or I have hitchhiked over the years, but I'm not, like, an expert in hitchhiking. And because there are hitchhiking experts, there's a lot of great resources online. So just Googling around, a lot of those common questions are addressed in some really interesting and nuanced ways. One thing that I did, literally the first place I hitchhiked in was Korea, which doesn't really count because, like, I'm a tall, fairly pasty American guy, and you're just, people see you on the side of the road and with your thumb out in Korea, and they think something's wrong, you know. That somehow I'm not threatening at all. Korea is so, you know, ethnically homogenous that, you know, they saw me at the side of the road and they just thought, oh, well, we'll pick this guy up. You know, it's like picking up, it's not the best analogy, but like a celebrity or something. You know, you're obviously not from there and you're probably going to be interesting, so they pick me up. Whereas my first hitchhiking experience in a country where I wasn't necessarily a foreigner was Lithuania. And I don't know if you know much about hitchhiking cultures in Lithuania, but hitchhiking is huge there. It's just not seen as a weird thing. And I think in the United States, I'm not sure how it was in Australia, but in the United States, maybe 70 years ago, hitchhiking was not seen as an unusual thing. And so, so my first in-depth hitchhiking experience was in Lithuania, where the highway was littered with young hitchhikers. You basically waited in line at the edge of a given town before you went hitchhiking. And and so that helped. And, you know, I'm a fairly big guy, and so maybe if I was a small woman, it would be different. And obviously women as travelers, not just hitchhikers, but travelers in general, follow a different set of rules. I found it to be no problem. And I think these days, in a country like the U.S. and probably even Australia, the people who pick up hitchhikers are people like you, who are just sort of interested in the prospect of seeing someone out there. Sometimes it's, you know, truckers or people who are bored or lonely and want somebody to talk to. But I think that there's an extent to which there's a code of hitchhiking that the people who take the trouble to pull over and pick you up are going to kind of get it. Another thing too, if you have a bad vibe, just don't go. You know, if somebody looks like a chainsaw mass killer, then just say, oh, I'm sorry. I was stretching my thumb. It's fine. My grandma just called me and she's going to pick me up. So don't be afraid to follow your instincts that way. And then also don't take it from me. There's a lot of online resources. I know there's people in the United States, people I've met at vagabonding events who have hitchhiking races and just make a game of it and have a lot of fun with it. And I think those guys were all pretty young, and there's something exuberant about picking up a hitchhiker who just doesn't want to get from point A to point B, but is like competing with somebody else. And the people who ended up picking those guys up had a lot of fun with it. And I think that they got into the imagination of the race. So yeah, it's a fun way to travel. It can be dangerous, but there's ways to make it less dangerous, and there's a lot of resources online about it.
Sure thing. So my next question is there a typical routine you follow after touching down in a new place or country?
Probably, you know, obviously there's getting out of the airport, going to the hotel, sleeping off my jet lag. But then it's just walking around. You know, a phrase I use a lot is walk until your day becomes interesting, which can apply to any day. But I like just walking to orient myself, even before. One thing that I try to avoid doing is immediately going to the most famous site in wherever I am. If I'm in Paris, I try to save the Eiffel Tower, Louvre type thing. And instead of going to the obvious places where you are supposed to go as a tourist, I just wander around in the neighborhood where my hostel is. If I know that there's a downtown area, I try to walk my way there. If it's a long way, maybe get a local bus, sort of get into the rhythms of how people in that city travel. And that's my best ritual, because in addition to, you know, orienting myself and sort of getting a feel for how everything looks, sounds, and smells, I can have some amazing experiences. I can meet people that way and just enter the context of the culture much more quickly than if I had started by going to the tourist zone. Excuse me, I have nothing against tourist zones, but I think sometimes just walking around is a truer expression of a place than going to the beautiful historical monument.
Sorry, just a second. I think my voice is reverberating a little bit. Let me see here. All right, it's all good now. Yeah, my first time, you know, traveling, I went to Bangkok, Thailand. I had been to New Zealand before, but it was all really new to me. I had this culture shock, and I remember, like, the first time I stepped out of the hostel on my very first night, I stepped out, and then straight away, like, 5 seconds after I stepped out, this guy on a, I forgot what they called him, but they got, like, these motorized tricycle things over in...
tuk-tuk.
Bangkok.
A tuk-tuk?
Yes, a tuk-tuk. And this tuk-tuk man pulls up and I look like this clueless traveler. And he pulls up, he walks straight over to me and he starts sort of speaking sort of broken English and he goes, oh, you want ride, you want ride. And literally for the next half an hour, he followed me around and followed me into a library and I was like the nice guy and I didn't really know what to do. And I said, no, sorry, I'm fine. But that wasn't enough. And just, you know, based on that experience, it really taught me that, you know, wow, it's important to adapt to the new area that you're in. It's very different because all I wanted to go was, you know, to this bus station to get to Chiang Mai in Thailand. And just to find like a taxi ride, it really opened me up to, okay, things are a little different here. And the way people act, I guess, is much different to what I'm used to. So I think, yeah, maybe spending a few days or like you were saying, just walking around, getting used to the culture could help sort of adjust.
And not being afraid of that. I think sometimes Bangkok was one of my early Asian travel cities. And I think I wanted to be a traveler who didn't make a mistake and wasn't the sucker who got followed around by the tuk-tuk driver. But I think that to an extent, that's inevitable. That's how you learn how a city works is by being looking like a fool sometimes or just doing something that you probably wouldn't do again or paying too much for something that you eventually learn is worth a quarter of that. Mm-hmm. And that's something that I encourage people to embrace is that when you first start traveling, of course, you're going to be a neophyte and a greenhorn, a beginner. And just allow yourself to make those mistakes. Don't beat your, obviously, you don't want to make mistakes that would get you, put your life in danger, but allow yourself to make those small mistakes, get lost a little bit, pay too much for this, you know, get followed around by a tout or a vendor here. And then eventually that's how you learn how things work, you know, and you meet a lot of people and have a lot of interesting experiences that way. So I think that's great. That's sort of a funny story you have now, that you were the nice guy who just didn't want to be rude. And then suddenly you have this accidental friend and God knows, you know, when he's going to leave you alone.
So. That's right. It happens. And I'm actually, yeah, I'm really grateful for that experience. It's always funny looking back at it. So my next question for you, Rolf, is what are the top three skills or qualities that every vagabonder needs to make the best of their travels?
Well, one of them, I think, is going to be something I mentioned before, which is patience. Patience is not just useful when you're saving money to travel, but it's very important once you're on the road, because I think we dream of travel, we draw up bucket lists, we have all these things that we want to do, and we get so excited about doing them all that it's easy to lose track of what's right in front of us. And so just being patient and realizing that your first day or week of travel is going to teach you so much about not just the place you're in, but about travel itself, that if you are thinking too much about the next destination, you're going to lose the joy of being where you are, and also the ability to spontaneously change your travels and change your mind, which is my second quality, which is flexibility. Patience, flexibility, meaning if you fall in love with a place or even a person that you had no idea would be so amazing, why not spend more time there or more time with this person, even though you had planned to go to the pyramids or Machu Picchu or some other amazing place that you thought you were supposed to go? If you don't allow yourself to change your plan, then you know, you're going to sell your trip short. You're going to be taking the trip you thought you were supposed to take instead of the trip that is right in front of you, instead of the trip that is presenting itself to you. And the final quality is probably humility. I think sometimes, even in those situations where an annoying tuk-tuk driver is following you around, there's a dynamic going on where you just have to be humble enough to accept things and listen and try to understand a place. And this is something, I don't know, I'm sure it applies to Australians to an extent, but it really applies to Americans, which is Americans are sort of trained to be assertive and confident. And sometimes if you're not humble, then you're just going to be the jackass foreigner who assumes one thing. And then when something else happens, you get angry. And so actually by being humble, you're just saving yourself a lot of wasted energy by just rolling with punches a little bit, allowing things to happen, understanding that other countries work in ways that are different to your home country. And if you listen three times as much as you talk and just attune yourself in a humble way and you know, cultivate the ability to laugh at yourself, then you can better enjoy that country or that part of the world where you are being patient and flexible as you travel. So those three elements go hand in hand, I think.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely love it. If you could only take three items with you on a trip around the world, apart from the clothes you're wearing, what would they be and why?
Well, about 7 years ago, I traveled around the world with no luggage at all. I don't know if you're aware of this, but it was called the No Baggage Challenge. I just had a travel vest and I put a few things in my pockets. Oh. And after a week, I got used to it. It was actually enjoyable. I mean, I had to wash my clothes every day because I only only had like one spare t-shirt, one spare set of socks and underwear. But it really made me realize that you don't need very much. And in an age where a smartphone serves 500 purposes at once, well, there's one, you know, you have the smartphone. And in addition to the clothes you're wearing, you don't need that much else. Maybe a toothbrush just so you can keep your hygiene together. And gosh, what else would you need? I think that there's very little you need. I think if you have a good attitude and just the willingness to be patient and go slow and take things as they come, there's really very little you need to bring. And the caveat here is that your smartphone is doing 500 things anyway. You know, it can replace your side reading and your guidebook. It can play your podcast and your music. I mean, there's just 15 years ago, the things that you can do with your smartphone would have weighed 500 pounds. You know, would have been impossible to carry. And so it's easier than ever to travel super light. And I'm a huge fan of traveling super light. And even I saw backpackers when I was traveling with no luggage, I saw backpackers and I thought to myself, those guys are carrying a bag full of dirty clothes, you know? and just the fact that I had to wash my clothes every day meant that I was as clean as I'd ever been. And once I got used to the idiosyncrasy of only wearing two sets of clothes the whole time, I just forgot thinking about it. And so there's something not just liberating, but just really enjoyable about traveling with very little. And I encourage people to experiment with minimalism on the road, because once you learn to adapt, man, you just don't need to bring very much.
Yeah, it's almost like you can get a lot of those things on arrival, like maybe even a toothbrush. If you skip a night or two, you could get a toothbrush, toothpaste over there. You get some extra clothes if you need them, some gloves, some boots, whatever you need. Maybe not even that. So it's really interesting you bring that up. So my next question for you, Rolf, is in your experience, how long does one need to spend in a country to have truly experienced it?
I don't feel qualified to say that authoritatively. And I think sometimes it's subjective, and that's why I encourage people not to be too fundamentalist about their itineraries. Because sometimes you go to a place and it just doesn't click for you, and you stay 4 or 5 days and it doesn't work. Well, maybe it's the wrong time in your life to experience that city and move on. Other times, just a place gets under your skin and pretty soon you're renting an apartment there. And so I think it's subjective. And the only footnote I'll add there is don't set limits, you know, and sort of trust your instincts. And so if you're in your third week of staying in Budapest and you feel a little bit bad because you were supposed to be in Athens by now, don't sweat it, you know, enjoy Budapest, continue to make friends and continue to have experiences and just go with your gut. So I think your own instincts can help you determine this, and your instincts get sharper the more you travel.
Sure. Now I got to ask sort of about relationships and travel. Are you married right now or in a long-term relationship?
Yeah, I'm dating. I don't know if you saw my girlfriend walk in the background. Yeah. I'm dating a woman now, but she lives in England. So it's not like we don't live in the same place. So it's not like a marriage type situation, but we've been seeing each other for quite a long time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Do you have any advice for those on the road and perhaps they've stumbled upon a girl that they might like or a man in this case, or whichever? You know, whatever people are into. And yeah, do you have any advice regarding that? Because if you have different ideas of where you want to go and how you travel, do you think that can become a big obstacle in a relationship? And is there a way to manage that?
It can definitely become a big obstacle in a relationship. I think there's something inherently romantic about travel, and you sort of in a heightened state and you meet people and you feel like the best version of yourself and they feel like the best version of themselves. I think it can't hurt to be open to the temporariness sometimes. You know, it's okay. You can feel strongly for someone, and then you can be apart for a few months. I think that's something that you learn, that part of the generosity of being with someone is allowing them and yourself time to be apart. You don't have to be attached at the hip once you meet somebody. And of course, my situation is different. When I was, you know, 10, 15 years ago, I was traveling more or less full time. I didn't have a house, right? And so even though travel is still a big part of my life, I have a more predictable life in a certain sense. And so it's not like, you know, I met my girlfriend on the road someplace, although technically I did, and then had to figure out going, you know, where we would go in the next week. So I no longer, you know, I have a home base and she has a home base, and we can sort of operate our relationship according. And so it's different than when I was a full-time vagabonder. So I don't really consider myself a full-time vagabonder now, even though I travel in the vagabonding style several months a year. I think it's something that you just figure out. And I think, you you know, I think one, traveling together is a good way to figure out your compatibility with someone who becomes a lover. And that great night on the Mekong River in Laos may be wonderful. And then 2 weeks later, you realize you just want to strangle this person. Hey, that's good information to have. So again, I think one need not see romance in all or none terms, that sometimes it's nice just to share a moment together and not to beat yourself up over where it's going. You know, I think sometimes you can travel together. You can move to the far off city of the person you fall in love with. But you don't have to. And I think it's very subjective. And I think sometimes, we become better at love by moving through it, you know? And so that, just like I say, make a lot of mistakes. The mistakes you make as an early traveler will make you a better traveler. Well, you're going to make a lot of romantic mistakes too, you know, and you're going to figure it out. And, I've known people who've met, a man or a woman within a month of leaving, and they spend the rest of their life, or at least their time up until now, with them. It's just, it made sense. And that's how it was. I've met other people who may have felt very strongly about a person, and then they drift apart, and that's fine. So that's another thing that you shouldn't overthink. There's going to be moments of romance on the road, and they might end disastrously. I'll give you an example. I actually met a Belgian woman in Egypt, and then we later met up in Thailand, and it just felt really nice. It felt really right in Thailand. So she invited me to visit her for a Christmas in Brussels, and almost like within 90 seconds of arriving, it just fell apart. Like, we were completely different people. Wow. We were sort of performing versions of ourselves in Thailand, and then we were just deeply, deeply not meant to be together. And so it was a depressing time. It was a deeply depressing time. She was sort of mean, actually. Mm-hmm. And I was sort of pathetic. But that was good to know. You know, it was a horrible experience, but my life, and we've since become friends, in a much more practical sense. But, I learned that way, that there's that you can idealize versions of yourself while you're traveling and realize that that's not who you are, and that's not who the other person is. And so, even though that's a very negative, it was a very negative experience. It was very stressful at time, or at least the breakup was. That helped me get to know myself, you know, and perhaps she got to know herself better too. So I might end my romance advice on that, of just be willing to make mistakes, be willing to be open-hearted, but broken-hearted too. It happened.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right on. All right, I'll just keep moving along and just really enjoying what you're saying so far. So, and sharing your stories. A few more questions here. Who's the strangest or quirkiest person you've met while on the road, and how did you meet them?
Well, my second book, Marco Polo Didn't Go There, is full of stories, and about one third of them are about strange and quirky people. So I could probably roll a Dungeons and Dragons dice and pick one. One of my favorites is Mr. Ibrahim, who's this guy I met in Beirut, and he was sort of this Lebanese Don Quixote who was tilting at windmills of an idealized Beirut. And if you know the history of Beirut, you know, it's this really beautiful, sophisticated city full of beautiful, sophisticated people, but it's been really torn up by war, just decade after decade. There's been war, sectarian strife, and it should be a Paris or a London, but it is a city that doesn't quite get there because of war. And Mr. Ibrahim was a guy who, he was actually very wealthy. He took me around. He had a driver, a bodyguard. He took me around in a Mercedes, showing me the city, but he refused to believe in the ugly and war-torn parts of Beirut. And that was very difficult, because war is a very visible part of Beirut. And the story I wrote about it, which is in my second book, Marco Polo Didn't Go There, is called My Beirut Hostage Crisis. And I was held hostage by Mr. Ibrahim, not because he was a bad guy, but because he was so exuberant about Beirut and Lebanon that he just wanted to show me every beautiful thing about the city. And I really couldn't say no. I mean, he was a little bit, there was something a little bit off about it. He was so over the top and so desperately in love with his fantasy vision of Beirut that you just couldn't say no to him. And as it turns out in the story, I eventually sort of inadvertently insulted him, you know, by not wanting to do one of these things he wanted to do. And he sort of shunned me, which is too bad, because he was a sweet guy at heart. He was just so overbearingly sweet that it drove me crazy. And one thing about the story is that, one thing about my second book is I put end notes. So each chapter I wrote, I put end notes, which is sort of a commentary track about how I wrote that. And I took a lot of really funny details about Mr. Ibrahim out of the story, because I didn't want to make him into a caricature. I wanted to make him a little bit quirky and a little bit funny, but also I wanted him to exude the sort of the tragedy that comes with a war-torn city that should be a great world city, but isn't because of war. I didn't want people to just laugh with me when I was with Mr. Ibrahim, but also sort of feel the longing and the pain that he felt. And so there was just some crazy things. Like he kept insisting that Lebanese were the first Christians, and that they were Christians in the year 600 BC. And it's like, Ibrahim, you can't be a Christian before Christ. You know, that's impossible. And he was having none of it. So he was just a weird guy. But as a travel writer, weird people are the bread and butter of good stories. So like I said, one third of my Marco Polo Didn't Go There book are stories, not just about places and interesting experiences and adventures, but about quirky people. So they're in their own, even when quirky people drive you crazy, they're a blessing of travel. So it's good to leave yourself open to them.
Mm-hmm. Sure thing. Okay. So I've heard places like, I don't know how to pronounce it, but, Myanmar, it borders Thailand. Do you know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah, Myanmar. You can call it Myanmar and people will understand, but it comes from the old Burmese name for that part of the world, which is Mien. Marco Polo wrote about Mien. So yeah. Myanmar is the country now.
Yeah. Okay. So, I don't want to like pick on this country, but it's just what, you know, you hear through people in the media and that sort of thing. And, you know, I heard people get like kidnapped or travelers get kidnapped over the border. And there's, I know you sort of speak briefly about this sort of thing in your book, Vagabonding. Is this something to be concerned about here in 2017, or is it just sort of the media and people spreading rumors that it's actually more dangerous than it really is?
Yeah, I think it's good to be aware of travel warnings, but the media is a man bites dog world. You know, like they say, nobody writes a newspaper story about a dog biting a man, because that's common. But when a man bites a dog, that's a little weird, and that's what's good. And so there's just no market for how safe and wonderful the world is. You know, you're only going to see and hear about places when things blow up or things go wrong or there's a refugee crisis. And so I love Myanmar. In fact, I wrote Vagabonding on the border of Thailand and Myanmar. So every month I would go for a visa run into Myanmar, into the very southern part of Myanmar. And it was just amazing. I rode a one-speed bicycle across Myanmar for several weeks. I just had these amazing, it's one of my favorite places. You use it as an example, but it's one of my favorite places. And if you only listen to travel warnings, then you might not see a truly amazing place. Another place that I really loved that I wouldn't go now, but Syria was always sort of on this terrorist state axis of evil list. And when I went there, I found Syrians to be just delightful and wonderful company and wonderful hosts. And unfortunately, because of the specifics of the situation there now, where kidnapping foreigners is a huge thing, I would never go there or recommend somebody go there now. But for the most part, the warnings that you hear about Myanmar or Mexico or other parts of the world, they have some credence, but it doesn't take that much to just be aware of your surroundings, have a great time in a country that might have a bad reputation. And a case in point I'll bring up is I was in Paris last summer and they had a terrorist attack in Nice on Bastille Day. And a lot of people emailed me and asked me if I was all right. And I had to sort of keep myself from saying, have you looked at a map of France? You know, when there was a shooting in Dallas, I didn't ask you if you were okay in San Francisco. You know, these countries are a long ways away. And I think even people who were celebrating Bastille Day in Nice that day in another part of the city may not have even known that that was happening. And so I think the bad things that happened, which one should be careful about, are very localized and they're very much man bites dog. They're the exception rule. And there's much to be said about going to countries that that aren't necessarily heavily touristed and might have a somewhat bad reputation, but often are wonderful places to go to. My girlfriend, who was here a second ago, is a filmmaker, and she went to Sudan to work on a TV show. And she has trouble getting into the United States now because Sudan is a, quote, terrorist state. But when she was there, she just thought people were great. People were so warm and so laid back and easy to get along to. So sometimes it's the places that you think are going to be problems or unwelcoming that turn out to be just the most delightful places to visit. So I would recommend, again, keep it in mind that you should be aware of your surroundings. I would hardly recommend Myanmar based on my experiences there.
Sure thing. Now, the next thing I want to ask you about, so we've got about, I'm just gauging time here, about 10 minutes. So I really want to move on to the digital nomad movement. Now, Tim Ferriss has claimed that, you know, you, Rolf, you partly inspired him to write that book, The 4-Hour Workweek, in 2007, I think it was. And since that's been published, you know, this digital nomad movement has really, really began to lift off. So there's, you know, tons of, a lot of people my age in their 20s, you know, working from their laptop, doing freelancing online, and sort of like traveling the world, you know, from place to place, over a span of a few months in each country, that sort of thing. And I'm just wondering, what your thoughts are on the movement and, you know, how you've sort of seen it evolve since you first wrote Vagabonding. Just wondering if you have any input on where that movement's going and how prominent it is in the world today.
there's an extent to which I'm not a big authority just on the digital nomad movement as a movement, because it sort of happened after my entree into that world. You know, I guess okay. Tim and to an extent myself have influenced it. And so I was already doing it. So I sort of have the luxury of not having to pay that much attention to it. You know, I sort of address the movement insofar as I give a lot of travel advice and a lot of people use my book within the digital nomad movement. I think it's fantastic. And I think it makes sense. And in fact, you know, Tim's book is 7 years old now. Mm-hmm. My book is 14 years old, I think. I'm sorry, Tim's book is 10 years old. My book is 14 years old. And I think it's great that this has happened because travel is very near and dear to me. But it also happened in tandem with, you know, the way smartphones and certain apps and ubiquity of social media and certain information being available has just made it that much easier. It's like there's the digital nomad movement, but there's also within that, it reinforces itself. You know, basically you have this greater community who sort of have the same thing in mind. And because a lot of these people are blogging and handing out advice and sort of broadcasting their experiences, it just takes the mystery out and a lot of the fear out of pulling the trigger and making it happen. So I'm a big fan of the movement in that sense, in that the digital nomads have demystified vagabond, really. They have reduced the number of excuses people have for not doing it, you know. And so I think it has promoted travel, and I think that's a great thing. If there's a downside to it, I think that there's such a technological component to digital nomadism because of the social media, because of the blog, because of the networking, that I think a lot of younger travelers don't fully appreciate unplugged travel, like non-connected travel, being able to put your smartphone away. A smartphone can help you in 100 ways, but it can also hinder you in one very basic way, which is taking you out of your environment. When you're staring into the black mirror of your smartphone, you're not interacting with your environment. When you're getting restaurant recommendation from your Twitter followers, you're not getting them from people on the street. So there's some great advantages to it, but there are some caveats. And, you know, I don't want to be the grumpy old guy who's sort of telling young people that they shouldn't travel in a certain way. I think technology is a great way to go. And I remember, like, old hippie era, when I first started traveling, hippie era people saying, oh, travel's too easy. You have these credit cards and phone answering machine stuff. And it's just like, really? So I don't want to be that guy. I don't want to be the get off my lawn travel guy. But I do want to encourage the digital nomad types to embrace the spontaneity and serendipity that comes with being able to turn off that constant connected state. It's a great way to get on the road, to inspire yourself to travel, to meet other people who are doing the same thing, and even to share your travels instantaneously with people around the world. But if you're not also turning off your smartphone, leaving it in the hotel, finding ways to interact at a face-to-face level in your environment, then you're selling your digital nomad experience short. So I think digital nomads should, from time to time, if you see digital nomad as a neon sign, just turn off the digital one sometimes. So it's just nomad. It's cool to be a digital nomad, but it's actually really awesome to just be a grit and bones, no technology, straight up nomad. And so allow yourself that luxury as well. Mm. So that's my rambling assessment of digital nomad. But I'm a big believer in turning off technology sometimes.
Yeah, fantastic. Yeah, thank you very much for those words. So rounding up now. Yeah, so for the last 5 minutes, I just want to speak a little bit about your success. Obviously, you know, you wrote Vagabonding. It's become a 100K bestseller. I'm just wondering, when did you start to feel that success coming your way? Because, you know, a lot of people reach out to you, like I have, to interview you, because you've clearly got a lot of knowledge and experience. And I've seen you on the road on some YouTube videos doing speeches. So when did you start to feel that success? And how have you managed it since?
It's interesting that, like, blessedly, I felt that success very quickly. For whatever reason, the book became successful pretty soon. And of course, Tim's championing the book made that, you know, that catalyzed everything. But I remember before I went on my very first book tour in 2003, other writers telling me, oh, well, don't feel too bad if only two people show up, you know, or if nobody shows up at all. Even on my first book tour, I consistently had like 30 people at least showing up to the events. And I think part of that, my book was so new that it didn't have a reputation yet, but I think people are naturally drawn to travel and the idea of travel and the philosophical existential idea of travel. And I think that grassroots success started very early, and I'm blessed to have seen that. And so I've had these different waves where early on, most people just sent me emails asking me questions. And then there was another phase where people would like friend me or follow me on social media or maybe say something to me on social media, but not necessarily, it's like they were too shy to contact me by email. And then I had all these people who wanted to interview me for their blogs, because blogs actually sort of blew up after Vagabonding. Vagabonding amount. And in the last 24 months, it's been podcast, you know, that, mm-hmm. 5 years ago, I would have done a series of written, interviews for a blog. Now, podcasts are the way to go. And I it doesn't surprise me because I'm a big fan and user of podcasts myself. Mm-hmm. I think it goes hand in hand with, the fact that, for example, Tim Ferriss has such a big following. When I appeared on his podcast, I think a lot of people, felt what I said there resonated. Tim has a big following. And so, people, when they start their podcasts, have invited me on. And so it's grown over the years and it hasn't really stopped growing. You know, it feels like as many people as ever are reaching out and are engaged by the book and are traveling themselves. Some people have read the book, traveled, met their spouse overseas, had kids, gone home, taken their kids out for a second time. You know, I was just, people who hosted me in Idaho over the weekend were a married couple that were traveling with their kids. And so it was fun to see people who've been interacting with my book over time. And so I try to appreciate that, you know, to not be jaded by the success of the book, because I feel really thankful that I've had the opportunity to find an audience, you know, that in some ways the book was written to a younger version of myself. I wanted to encourage that younger version of myself, not just in a practical, but a philosophical way. And it turns out that people are responding to that, and I couldn't be happier that people are.
Mm, right on. Yeah, thank you. So where can people find you on social media, Rolf? And find out, if I recall correctly, you're writing a new book. Where can we find out more about that as well?
Go to rolfpotts.com. I have a few social media feeds, but because of my conflicted relationship with social media, sometimes those go silent for a while. Rolfpotts.com has links to my social media, but also links to dozens, if not hundreds, of old travel stories, travel advice, advice about non-travel topics, all of my books, including my new one, which comes out next March 2018. It links to my No Baggage travel blog, my old Vaga blog, travel advice blog. So it's just a good place to sort of get a sense for who I am, what I've written, and then you can find my social media feed from there.
Mm, yeah, fantastic. All right, too easy. So to the listeners listening in, I'll leave Rolf's links in the description of wherever this podcast is distributed. And Rolf, I just want to say thank you again. When I saw you schedule a call with me, I did a little dance, not going to lie. I was really excited. So this has been super valuable, not just for me, but hopefully for you as well and the listeners listening in right now. So sharing your time with us today. I really appreciate it, Rolf.
Awesome, Brandon. Thanks a lot, and happy vagabonding.
You too, Rolf. All right, I'll catch you later.
Take care.
If you'd like 3 gold nuggets from the book I'm currently reading, packed into a short, entertaining weekly email, then head to brandonnankivell.com/subscribe. This is also the best way to interact with me and keep up with what I'm doing. Again, head to brandonnankivell.com/subscribe. As usual, thank you for listening, my friends. I release new episodes every week. Make sure you don't miss one by subscribing. It's super easy and means a lot to me. Go to iTunes, search for The 1% Show, and click subscribe. Once again, I'm your host, Brandon Nankivell, and I'll see you in the next episode.